Father God, we come and we are grateful that you are that good Father. And God, we come, we've been your prodigal sons and your prodigal daughters. And yet, God, we come running back to you. But it's amazing, God, as we run to you, that you've been always right there waiting for us.
Yes, looking for us.
And so, God, we're grateful that you love us, that you forgive us, that you restore us. You're perfect in all your ways. And so, God, we thank you. So, God, we come right now asking, Lord, that you give us ears to hear your voice. Give us a heart that we might receive your word. God, that we might follow your direction. We thank you, God. We praise you for what you've already done. So bless us right now is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. It's a good, good Father. Amen. We praise God for a Father who takes good care of his children. Amen. 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 If you have your Bibles with you, as we celebrate this Palm Sunday, it's not a Palm Sunday scripture, but it is God's word. I believe it speaks to us today. Romans chapter 5. All right. I want you to focus your attention on verses 6, and we're going to read through verses 11. Romans chapter 5, starting at verse 6, and we'll read through verse 11. This is what the Word of God says. For while we were still helpless, at the appointed moment, Christ died for the ungodly. For rarely will someone die for a just person, though for a good person, perhaps, someone might even dare to die. But God proves his own love. For some of your versions says he demonstrates his own love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Verse 9. Much more then, since we have now been declared righteous by his blood, we will be saved through him from wrath. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, then how much more, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life? And not only that, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. You need a title for the day. It's simply reconcile through the cross. Reconcile through the cross. Today I present to you two scenes. Two scenes. The first scene is you enter into a courtroom in cuffs. I know some of y'all, that scene just kind of jacks you up a little bit. The bailiff brings you from out back and sits you at the defendant's table. You and your lawyer know you are guilty. Know you're guilty of all charges, and you deserve the ultimate penalty. Listen, after a brief conference with your lawyer, he turns to the court and states, Your Honor, my client is guilty. He has made a full confession. However, I've decided to serve out his penalty. Also, Your Honor, I would like to make a motion to the court that the defendant's record be expunged. The court turns and says, I accept the plea. And your motion is granted. You see, your advocate is then cuffed and whisked away to serve your penalty. You're guilty, yet the one who is innocent takes the penalty on your behalf, and it is as if you have never committed a crime. The court declares you not guilty and your record is now clean. Scene two. You enter Starbucks. You know, some of y'all getting Joneses right now. Amen. Y'all still know what that means, right? The Joneses, amen. All right. You've been estranged from your father as long as you can remember. Back in the day, you were kind of smelling yourself, and it caused a rift between you and your dad. The relationship was destroyed. There seemed to be no hope for restoration as you continue to ignore the father's efforts to mend the relationship. And now you enter Starbucks and sit in the presence of your father. A mediator has stepped in, and through their efforts, the relationship has been reconciled. Through the mediator, the relationship that was once severed, the relationship that was severed by hurt, by brokenness, selfishness, and rebellion has now been restored. And see, you may say to yourself, listen, I ain't never been to court and I don't have no daddy issues. Me and my pops are cool. And today is Palm Sunday. What does that Starbucks in the courtroom have to do with Jesus at all? And see, listen to this. Each of us is guilty of sin. See, we didn't have a leg to stand on before the court, amen? And we were guaranteed to pay the price for our sin. Each of us, because of sin, was estranged from our Heavenly Father and were in need of restoration of our relationship. Thus the court and Starbucks. It's at the cross that the court was in session and we were declared not guilty by the blood of Christ. It's at the cross that God's disobedient and wayward children were reconciled with their loving Father. It may not have been over a cup of coffee, but it was at Calvary's cross that broken relationship was now restored. See, we got a good Father. Amen. So if you need a principle today as we talk about being reconciled through the cross, it is this. We were God's enemies because of sin. It was Christ's death on the cross that reconciled us back to God. And the things that we're going to learn as we walk through these scriptures today is this. Through the cross, God demonstrated his grace toward us. Through the cross, God demonstrated his grace toward us. Through the cross, God demonstrates his love toward us. And through the cross, God demonstrates our reconciliation to him. Amen. It's through the cross and through the cross. So the centerpiece, as we get a little context for what we're talking about today, the centerpiece of Romans chapter 5 is the basis and blessing of justification. See, that's a theological term, but not too sophisticated. Amen. Namely, being at peace with God. See, in the preceding chapters of Romans, the Apostle Paul painstakingly addresses our justification by Christ. See, you have to understand justification, this Greek word translated justify or justification means to acquit, thus the court. It also means to vindicate or to pronounce righteous. See, these are important judicial terms, and the theological meaning is borrowed just from the courtroom. See, we had a record. I know some of y'all fought painstakingly to keep your record clean. Amen. But we came here with a record, born in sin, shaped in iniquity. Amen. And listen, we not only came here with a record, but we had a just God that must punish all crime. We had a just God that must punish all crime. See, in justification, God clears those who have been charged with sins or failures. See, the Bible makes it clear that God will clear no one of the charge of sin based on his or her own record. See, you can't come to the Lord at your sentence and say, Lord, listen, I've been doing some good community service. I've been wonderful to people. I've been nice. I've been this. I've been that. You cannot clear your record by your own efforts. Amen. It is by faith alone that we are justified, made right before God. He declares us righteous. Amen. in fact, the basis for peace is what Paul has been presenting all through Romans, amen, through to the end of chapter 4. He has been redirecting us to the cross, amen. He lets us know that, listen, I know some of us think we saved from hell. Listen, you ain't saved from hell. That's a byproduct, amen, that you are saved from hell. But we're actually saved from a righteous God's wrath.
Right, right.
See, God must punish sin, amen. We're saved from God's wrath. Romans 1:18 speaks of that. It says, for God's wrath is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of people who by their unrighteousness suppresses the truth. God's wrath poured out on those who have been rebellious toward him. However, God's wrath for the believer has been satisfied by the atoning sacrifice offered by Christ on the cross. Amen? You don't know, that's good news. As we walk through Romans chapter 3, verses 23 through 25 said this, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. They are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. God presented him as a propitiation, which means satisfaction, through faith in his blood to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his restraint, God passed over the sins previously committed. Amen. If you don't know this, it plays an important role. The Passover celebration is a picture of what Christ did for us. Amen. On the cross. It was his blood that marked out the doorposts of our lives. And because of his blood on our lives, death passes over us. See, if you want to get a little background, you got to go back to the Old Testament and check out Exodus. Amen. So listen, God's justice has been demonstrated and satisfied in that same event. Romans 3:26 says this, God presented him to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time so that he would be righteous and declare righteous the one who has faith in Jesus. See, our God is a faithful God. See, all this is to say peace with God depends on his being at peace with us, not our being at peace with him. See, us being made right before God depends on him, not upon us. It's based on faith. So what difference does it make? It makes a world of difference. Amen. See, the primary difference is that the person enters into a new realm. As believers, we enter into a realm of peace with God. What has once been a relationship marked by the wrath of God directed towards sin is now a relationship based on peace, amen, based on the fact that the hostility between us and God has been satiated by the cross. See, we now have peace with God through the work of Christ on the cross. See, that peace that Adam jacked up in the garden, amen. I know we like to blame Adam, but listen, we got a little Adam in us,
right.
And a little Eve. Listen, all y'all Eves in the house, it ain't the stain of your sister that's the problem.
Right.
It's the residue of your brother on your life.
Right.
See, Adam made us guilty before a just God. Christ justified us before our just God in the courtroom. He declared us innocent. See, listen, in essence, Romans 5 is the apostle's explanation of the last two words in Romans 4, our justification.
Right.
See, he explained two basic truths, the blessings of our justification and the basis for our justification. Today, we just going to hang out in the blessings.
Right, right, right.
Amen. We praise God for the basis, but today we're going to hang out in the blessings. See, I love in Romans chapter 5, those opening first five verses, we see the triad of Christian character, amen, faith, hope, and love, amen. We see the triad here. Listen, just walk with me for a second through these verses. It says this, therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We also obtain access through him by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also rejoice in our afflictions. See, I know we're paused right there. We rejoice in our afflictions because we know that afflictions produces endurance. Endurance produces proven character. And proven character produces hope. And this hope will not disappoint us because God's love has been poured into our hearts, in our hearts, through the Holy Spirit who was given unto us. See, it is by faith that we believe in the hope of glory whose love has been poured into our hearts. It is by faith in Jesus Christ that we obtain peace with God. It's not because of your own efforts. It's not because you're so wonderful, so good, so kind. It's not by your weekly attendance at church. It's not because you go to Bible study or you read the Bible 2, 3, or 4 times. It's not because you say God bless you to somebody. It's not because you gave a dollar to the poor. It's not because you give riches or anything else. It is by faith and what Christ has done on the cross alone. It's by faith. It's by faith. And so as we get into the meat of this text, the first thing we see here in verses 6 through 7 is that through the cross, God demonstrates his grace. Through the cross, he says, for while we were sinners, while we were still helpless, at the appointed moment, Christ died for the ungodly. For rarely will someone die for a just person, though for a good person, perhaps someone might even dare to die. See, the first thing we see here is, again, for why we were still helpless. See, in the Greek, this word is in a moral sense, and it speaks about wretchedness or being diseased. It is like a state of sin, a state of wretchedness. While we were yet still funky, while we were yet still stinky with sin, amen, while we were helpless, it has nothing to do with your physical condition. But yet you were helpless because in our physical, in our spiritual condition, we had no way to work our way to Jesus. Right. While we were helpless. And he says, at the proper time. See, this refers to the time that God appointed for Christ's atoning death on the cross. It wasn't like God sat down and looked at the calendar and said, oops, hey, I got to get that cross thing taken care of. Hey, my folks been in dealing with sins so long. I think it's time. Jesus, listen, if you look at the Gospels, it was often that they sought to seize Jesus. Now Jesus was what they consider a rebel. They would come times and they would try to arrest him. And they're like, hey, where is he at? Because he just slid away. It was times he would tell them, listen, ain't my time yet. They because he knew that it was not time, but God had an appointed time. That he would go to the cross and die for our sins. So at the appointed time, he came. Galatians 4, verses 4 and 5 tell us this. When the time came to completion, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law so that we might receive adoption as sons. At his perfect time. Amen. And then he talks about, listen, some of us, you know, may give our life for a righteous person. Amen. Some of us might even lay our life down for a good person. Amen. He says only rarely Paul uses this term to assert a general truth to highlight the extraordinary nature of Christ's death on behalf of the ungodly. Listen, it's one thing to die for somebody who is good. Right. It's one thing to die for somebody you think is just righteous. Right. But to die for your enemy? To die for those that you know are straight evil, that are straight rebellious, that are straight ungodly. Oh, to die for us. Amen. It is a demonstration of his grace. See, God demonstrated his grace through the cross. We were helpless, but at the right time, Christ died for the undeserving, you and me. We didn't earn it. We didn't deserve it. He freely gave his life. It was a demonstration of his grace. It was a demonstration of his unmerited favor. See, while we were yet helpless, while we were yet bucking against him, while we were yet fighting against him, while we were yet running, Christ still died for us by his grace. It was a demonstration of his grace. So not only was it a demonstration of his grace, it also demonstrates his love. The cross demonstrates his love. Through the cross, we see God demonstrating his love. I love this verse. It's one of my favorite verses in the scripture. But God proves his love, his own love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, since we have now been declared righteous by his blood, we will be saved through him from wrath. The New American Standard talks about, for God demonstrated his love toward us while we were yet in our sins. Christ died for us. See, Christ died for us is the proof and revelation of God's love for his people. As it says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave. See, God is not one of those that talk about love. Sisters, y'all know the Max that always talked about love. Baby, I love you. Baby, I'm just thinking about you. You know, I'm going to do this for you. I'm going to do that for you. Amen. But, you know, those are just mostly empty words. Amen. Right. See, God gives us his not romantic love, his agape love. Amen. That benevolent love, love that you can't earn. Love that's poured out on you. Amen. He demonstrated his love. He said, listen, I love you so much, I'm going to give you my best. I'm going to send my son. Amen. While we were yet sinners. See, most of us think we need to clean up our lives to get right with God. Amen. It's something, you know what? I'm going to stop cussing so I can just feel closer to God. I'm going to stop doing this. I'm going to stop doing that. Then I'm going to get in church. I'm going to get right. Listen, you can't get right without Jesus. See, when he died for you while you was drunk. He died for you while you was a liar. He died for you while you was a thief. He died for you while you were a manipulator. Amen. He died for you while you were yet running for him. While we were yet sinners. While we were yet in our mess. Christ died for our sins. He demonstrated his love. It is action. Amen. He not only did that, but he declared us righteous. See, Christ's righteousness was credited to our account. We are not righteous on our own. We've been declared righteous. This is an accounting term. If you go through Romans, you'll find the term imputed, which means that God has deposited to your account his righteousness. See, we were righteously bankrupt. We had no righteousness of our own. Amen. Listen, none of us are righteous in our own way. Amen. It is because of Christ's righteousness. He imputed, he credited to our account his righteousness. So when they run your spiritual bank account and they look at your account, it's full of righteousness, don't think it's your money. That's Christ's righteousness. And that is on your account. Amen. When folks are, oh, Bert, you so good. You so wonderful. That ain't me. That's Christ's righteousness in me. Oh, Devin, you're such a godly woman. Amen. No. I'm godly because God has credited to my account Christ's righteousness. So when you're looking at me and you're looking at my good deeds, you're looking at God through me. He demonstrates his love. So what basis have we been declared righteous? It is by his blood, through Christ's death, which he gave to the ungodly, and to make us in right relationship with God. His atonement through the sacrifice required blood. See, the Bible tells us in Hebrews 9:22, according to the law, almost everything is purified with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Or some verses say there is no remission of sin. See, many of us wonder, why would Christ atone for our sins in such a bloody account? Why all through Leviticus, because some of y'all stopped already at Leviticus in your yearly Bible reading. Amen. Why all the blood of the bulls and goats and blood on the earlobe and blood on this and blood on that? Amen. Because it was a picture of the blood that must be shed for our sin. For the wages of sin is death. The death penalty means that blood must be shed. But instead of us shedding our blood, Christ shed his blood that washed us white as snow. See, and he says in the verse, we'll be saved. We will be saved by his life. In this context, the Greek verb used here probably refers to the deliverance from final judgment. Not only are we saved now, Amen. But when we go to the judgment seat, we're saved from the final judgment. Amen. Not only do you live saved now, but you have a promise that when you go before the Lord, you have access to heaven. Amen. We are saved, but we are being saved from God's wrath because of the cross. We've been saved. So through the cross, God demonstrates his grace, and he also demonstrates his love. But not only that, this is the shouting party that's coming right now. Through the cross, God demonstrates our reconciliation. Amen. Some of us got some broken stuff. Amen. Some of us been jacked up. Amen. And we got some broken relationships. But through the cross, God demonstrates our reconciliation with him. Verse 10 says, "For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, then how much more, being reconciled, will we be saved by his life? And not only that, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have now received this reconciliation through him." Right. Listen, growing up, I had some enemies. There's some folk that, you know, when I used to go to Vanguard Junior High School, and there were some cats. Every time I get an opportunity, I'm going to meet you in the alley. You my sworn enemy. I don't like you. I don't like nothing about you. And every time opportunity I get, we gonna scrap because you my sworn enemy. Ain't no peace. Don't shake my hand. Don't give me no nod, nothing. You got nothing coming because you are my enemy. Amen. Here it is. The scripture says that we were enemies of God. I know many of y'all said, no, but I love God. Even before I came to Jesus, I recognized the man upstairs. I had respect for him. Listen, Jesus said, either you're with me or you're not. You can sugarcoat it all you want. Amen. It's cats, I could have pretended like I had love for you, but they know down on the deep on the inside if they had an opportunity. See, we were rebellious to God. God did nothing but try to love us. And yet, we were born in sin, stained with iniquity, so we came here enemies of the cross. Amen? We were his enemies. Paul is referring to a mindset of humanity's rebellion against God's ways and God's wrathful response to their sinful way. Jesus says, listen, men love the darkness. They don't try to twist it. It ain't like they come to the light. No, men like the darkness, amen? Listen, when we was up in the club, since Marty brought it up, since when we was up in the club, we want the light just right because we don't want too much bright light. We want to be able to slither. See, because we know that at the end of the night, if you stay till the club close, and when the lights come on, some of y'all be like, hey, baby, can I get that number back? Yeah. Some of y'all sisters gonna be like, I'm happy I gave him my fake number. Because the lights, see, none of y'all know the truth. The lights will expose what's in the darkness. Listen, men without God love the darkness. Amen. We were his enemies. And yet, God says, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. See, that seems a little oxymoronic that we would be reconciled through the death of his son. See, we needed to be brought back in. The only way that we can be made right with God was by his son's death. See, when it talks about we were reconciled, the Greek word here used is katalasso. It describes bringing two hostile parties into a relationship, a friendly relationship. See, reconcile is to reestablish proper, friendly, interpersonal relations after they have been disrupted or broken. See, the word implies a restoration of relationship, a return of the harmony that once existed between God and human beings. See, when Adam was in the garden, when God first created Adam and Eve, they were in harmony with God. See, they had a perfect relationship with God, but sin severed that relationship. See, the point is that Conversion brings both a change of position and a psychological and spiritual change. So our inner attitudes are brought into harmony with the divine. See, we who were once enemies of God now rejoice in God through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. See, once God had a beef with us. See, we had no basis for our rebellion against him because he's a good father. Amen. But he had a basis for judgment on us. See, through the death of his son, the death of Christ was the means by which God and humanity were reconciled. It was through Christ's death God pardoned the sinner and condemned the sin, thereby demonstrating his care and concern for sinful humanity. See, here, justification is a judicial term, but reconciliation is a relational term. It has to do with our interpersonal relationship with Jesus Christ. See, that's why many of us, we talk about the fact that I have a relationship with God. I have a relationship with God. So what's your relationship look like?
Right.
What's your relationship? Is it a one-sided relationship? Amen. Where the Father continues to pour out his love towards you and he's always chasing you down. Parents, you know how it is sometimes. Here we're trying to take care of our kids, give them everything they want, and we find ourselves trying to chase them down. They're rebelling. They're out, you know, staying past their curfew, spending money they don't have, room toe up, amen. And we're constantly trying to restore them, trying to show them this is what God would have for you. See, here it is, God trying to come to us and restore our broken relationship so that we can be in harmony with him. When you come to Christ, there's a change that should take place in your life to let you know that you've been restored back to the Father. Listen, it was something interesting when you look at the account of the prodigal son in the Gospels that says that the father was constantly on the road looking for his son. The story doesn't tell us how long his rebellious son was gone, but the scripture says when he came to his senses, he said, listen, my father's servant eat better than this. I'll go to my father's house, fall on his mercy. But he was stunned when he came down the road and his father saw him and his dad ran to him. Listen, God ran to us by sending his son on the cross, who gave his very life for us. See, through the death of his son, we've been redeemed. We've been restored. And listen, by his life, as the scripture says, refers to the resurrection life of the risen Christ. We are saved by our union with the risen Christ and his mediation on our behalf. As we come on next week and celebrate the resurrection, it is as Jesus died on the cross, and now because he lives, he is our advocate that is pleading on our behalf, mediating our case to stay reconciled to the Father.
Amen.
And then this last verse, 5:11, talks about, and now we are rejoicing. Through whom we now have reconciliation, we can rejoice through Jesus Christ. See, in Christ, for the restoration of our relationship with the Father, we can have joy. See, the reconciliation indicates that Jesus has repaired the relationship between God and his creation. And see, some of y'all was tripping when I started talking about Starbucks. What Starbucks got to do? See, because of Christ, you sat down at the table with your Heavenly Father, and now he has restored that broken relationship. See, sin separated our relationship with Christ. We had no means to get it right, but through Christ, he has mediated our relationship. So I close 2 Corinthians 5:18-21. Paints a perfect picture of why we need to be reconciled to the Father. Listen, says this, everything is from God, whom reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself and not counting their trespasses against them. And he has committed the message of reconciliation to us. Verse 20, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. certain that God is appealing through us, we plead on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. He made the one who did not know sin to be sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. See, he saved us. He reconciled us so that we can be ministers of reconciliation. I know you said, well, I ain't no reverend, I ain't no preacher, I ain't no minister. All of us are called to be ambassadors of Christ. We take the message of reconciliation. Listen, you've been restored with God. Why wouldn't you want somebody else to be restored? If God has saved you, why you wouldn't want them to be saved too? I know some of us are like, well, if you know what they did to me, I don't want them to have nothing good. Let's roll the record and see what you did. Let's open up the books and see what you did. Oh, but I'm sorry, the book has been washed in the blood. So you can't even, listen, God has expunged your record. Why are you holding somebody else's record against them?
Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
How else can God say, pray for those who spitefully use you? Bless those who curse you. Those who treat you evil return good. See, because it's not in your own power. You know your record. If you know your record, you should be, listen, I've been cleaned by the blood, amen? Hey, I don't have no problem blessing you. I want to make sure I'm in right standing with the God who saved me. Be reconciled. See, we were God's enemies because of sin. It was Christ's death on the cross that reconciled us back to him. See, I love it. He demonstrated that through the cross by his grace. We're saved by grace. Listen, those believers who got their nose in the air acting like they did something for God, it is by grace that you have been saved, that not of yourselves, amen? It is by faith through grace, grace by faith, amen? Listen, you cannot earn your way to heaven, so why should you expect somebody else to?
Right.
See, through the cross, God demonstrates his love, amen? Listen, it is an action word here. Love is an action word. The scripture tells us, listen, just don't show love in your words, but show it in your deeds.
Right.
Amen. What does your love look like?
Right.
Is it just words on the paper, or is your love alive? Amen. Part of the vision we talk about is to love like Christ. How did Christ love?
Right.
He demonstrated his love.
Right.
He was willing to lay down his life even for his enemies. We won't even buy our enemies a cup of coffee. But yet he shed his blood. Amen? Listen, when we look at this, not only does he demonstrate his grace, his love, he demonstrates the fact that we have been reconciled to God. Don't miss that. Our relationship was jacked up, but yet God brought us back together with him. See, it tells us in Peter, for Christ died for sin once and for all, the just for the unjust, in order to bring us back to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. See, this is a love story, y'all. We look at the cross, it's a love story. Amen. It may seem ugly what they did to Jesus. It was terrible what they did to him, but it was a love story. He did it for love. He laid down his life for love. See, theologically, God takes the initiative in reconciling sinful humankind to himself. Having done this initially, God then commits the message of reconciliation to us, the ones who've been reconciled, in order that we may seek reconciliation of others.
Yeah.
We become ambassadors of Christ, ambassadors of reconciliation. Do you know when you're an ambassador, you don't go on your own behalf? You represent the one who commissioned you.
Yeah.
Listen, all of us who serve God, we've been commissioned to go and represent him to a world that is perishing,
right.
A world that is on its way to destruction. We are to go and share the gospel message of reconciliation. See, peace with God is based on something God has done, not on how you feel.
Right.
It's based on God's sacrifice. Not your sacrifice. See, this peace was brokered on the cross. cross, the Christ reconciled me and you back to our Father on the cross so that we can tell someone else about that gospel. That gospel that saves, that gospel that transforms, that gospel that changes our destiny. So today, I urge you today, those of you who know you are estranged from the Father, who know that you are still struggling with the heavy weight of the guilt of your sin, be reconciled today. See, there is reconciliation through the cross. As the song says, listen, Jesus went to Calvary. See, y'all thought I was going to sing it. Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. That's love. See, this is a love story. Amen. The good Father sent his Son who gave his life for us. Amen. He went to Calvary's cross to save us, to give his life for us. He who knew no sin took on sin and nailed it to the cross. Now that's love. We have reconciliation through the cross. Be reconciled today to your Father. And listen, you don't have to stay in the courtroom guilty. Amen. You can be justified today. You don't have to sit in Starbucks wondering if your daddy loves you. You can be reconciled today. Be reconciled to the good Father who demonstrated his love, that while we were yet helpless, while we were yet jacked up, he sent his Son who died on the cross for our sins so that we might have life and have life more abundantly. Amen. Amen. Give God a hand of praise. A good Father. Amen. Amen.